Hello, Republic of Gamers, and welcome to ROG SideQuest, our podcast where we talk about, well, pretty much anything in the gaming world. Welcome, welcome. My name is Solid Jake, and I'm joined here by Brian May, aka Mayday, and Chris Barr, also known as Feigned. Chris, how you doing? What's new? What have you been playing lately?
Dude, I'm great. Honestly, been playing some Cyberpunk, been playing Rocket League. We're going to talk about it later, but jumping into some Squadrons, just trying to keep busy.
Brian, welcome, welcome. How about you? What have you been playing lately? I saw you on Black Mesa.
I'm so sorry. I just lost audio. I don't know.
Oh my goodness.
Sorry. I apologize. I can see you guys talking in the pause, so I'm so sorry.
He's like jamming. He's watching the stream. He's like, I love this show. This is going to be great.
I'm so sorry.
That's three apologies. Will you apologize more?
Classic.
Oh, classic.
Yep. Yeah. Brian hit me up the other night asking about, he's like talking about Half-Life and wanting to play some Half-Life. He's like, should I go back and play those? And I was like, dude, if you're gonna play the first one, try out Black Mesa. Like, that's what you should jump into. If I go back and play it again now that Black Mesa's finished, like that's the Half-Life 1 experience that I want to go have.
You know, it's interesting though, because those games did age very well. Are you good?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm okay. So sorry.
But we're talking about Half-Life, and I mentioned that you've been playing Black Mesa. I saw on Steam. So,
yeah, this is my first run through it, and let me tell you, it feels like I've been missing out for a really long time. And thanks to Chris for the recommendation, but I'm loving it,
dude. Yeah. I gotta say, I've been a gamer for long time, and that was always my biggest fraudulence, was I had never played Half-Life. And I played Half-Life for the first time in anticipation of Alex. I played it back in, you know, probably 2019, I want to say, is when I actually did play it, right around the time they announced Alex. And this was before Black Mesa had been completed, but I could not believe it how well those games aged. So you're playing like a fan mod, but honestly the controls are identical, and the gunplay is something that really shines, I feel, in Half-Life. It's better than some modern games, like it's better than Cyberpunk. Oh, yeah. I'll say that.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah. I'm just really loving it, and I got to play Portal earlier this year for the first time. I know I'm not a true gamer until you played Portal, but yeah.
No.
Cool.
No gatekeeping here.
Well,
but seriously, Portal, those games are so fun.
God, yeah. I'm looking forward to replaying them, because it's been long enough to the point where, like, I feel the puzzles might feel fresh for me, because I haven't played them in 10 plus years probably. So those games are...
Maybe we should do a Portal, like a co-op stream or something sometime.
There is multiplayer in Portal 2, right?
There is. I've never done the co-op, so that could be a fun time.
Okay. All right. We're on to something here. Well, guys, today we're going down, like, these niche gaming communities lately. Last week, we jumped in, we talked about rhythm games. Jeff and I, we talked about DDR, Beat Saber, you know, these VR rhythm games, and took that from the perspective of, like, fitness gaming and stuff you can do at home. Well, this is like the other spectrum, where you're not going to be moving at all. You're going to be seated in a cockpit. And, you know, we're seeing more and more people getting into sim racing. And then there's, of course, this flight sim and the space sim. And I'm actually a big fan of space sims, and we've actually been playing a bit of Squadrons together lately. So it's like, okay, well, let's talk about this whole ecosystem. Now, I guess we can just open the conversation with control schemes before we jump into games, because I think that's one of the interesting things to talk about here. And you know, I'll just open with mine, because why not? So let's see. Now, this is my over-the-shoulder cam. I actually don't have a camera on my feet right now, but this is my... I have foot pedals for when I play these games, for basically forward, backwards, movement, braking, all that stuff. I've got dual flight stick. This is good for the omnidirectional style. It's not good for all games, but I'm able to bind all of this for Squadrons, which is really satisfying. It gives you a lot of different, a lot of good control. I play games like Star Citizen with this. This wouldn't necessarily be great for Microsoft Flight Sim, because you're not using dual stick to fly a real airplane. You could probably finagle something to make it work, but it might be a little bit weird. But you know, it's a pretty neat little set up where you know, again, this is like a better lit version. You can see the two sticks. And these are two, like, you know, entry-level flight sticks. They're nothing fancy. They work. They do the job. But this is one approach. This is the dual stick setup. And Chris, I have a photo here of your setup. Let's talk about it here.
It's a favorite of mine, yeah. So, yeah, when Flight Sim and Squadrons were coming out, I ended up jumping on and upgrading because I'd been using the same flight stick. I think it was the Logitech Extreme 3D Pro. It's the same one I used back in 2004 to play Star Wars Galaxies Jump to Lightspeed. So it's like, it was time to update. It's not as well supported by modern games anymore, so I jumped to this HOTAS setup. So I've got my right-hand stick, and then I've got, oh my god, what do I even
call the throttle.
The throttle. So I've got that, and it just, I don't know, it sinks me into that feeling like I am in control of a ship or a plane or something. It makes me feel like I'm in a cockpit in a way that just a single stick or a gamepad just doesn't. So I have just so many, like, I don't know if you can see all the switches and buttons. There are probably close to 100 different buttons or switches that I can activate. And I actually still have to keep a window open with some of my key mappings for Squadrons because I still don't have them all memorized.
There's a lot, yeah.
But it's amazing. And I love that we're looking at the Zephyrus Duo. So we've got the dual screens in a laptop, and a game like Microsoft Flight Sim, I can pull out the different windows so you can see like my navigation. I can look at some of my tools, my instruments and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I really love this setup that I've gotten to put together, and it's portable too. Like I can take that literally anywhere. The flight sticks are the biggest and bulkiest part of it.
Yeah. The stick plus throttle setup with this, and, you know, having the multi-display thing, this is truly an amazing setup for Flight Sim. Plus, that's a 4K display, I believe. Even the portable display is 4K? The one on top?
No, the portable display is just 1080, which is great.
Oh, it's a high refresh rate, though. That's what it
navigation.
Is. Yeah.
It is. It's 240, I believe 240, it is.
It's, like, ridiculously high.
240. But the main screen on the laptop is a 4K at 60, which is brilliant for playing Microsoft Flight Simulator, because it's a little too demanding to be running it at high refresh rates. Mm-hmm. But a game like Flight Sim, like, I can honestly play at like 30 plus frames, and when you're cruising up at, you know, 10,000 feet, it looks buttery smooth. So I just love it.
Yeah, that's got to feel so immersive. I mean, just like the screen pad there, and just being able to, you know, look down and it feels like a control panel. Like, that's sometimes what I feel like I'm missing.
Yeah, it is. It's like I get that feeling like I'm in a cockpit. Like I want to start, you know, reaching in my screen and pressing buttons, but like I've got them all on the stick, so I actually get that same kind of sense. It's truly immersive, and I like, you can see, like, I like to do fun stuff with my lighting, so I actually bring the lights way down when I'm flying, so
that's cool.
Nothing else is in my periphery. I actually have a second setup. That's my portable setup. When I'm on my main desktop, I actually use an ultra wide, so I can get that kind of surround periphery view.
That's what I need
going on.
That's what I'm lacking.
It's a nice step up.
So those are two things I want to get to soon. I want to talk about different displays in these kinds of sims, and I also want to talk about working in integrating touch screens to these setups. But before we get there, Brian, what do you play with?
Well, you know, I grew up with games like Rogue Squadron, you know, on the GameCube and stuff like that. So I've always been a controller guy. And to this day, that's it right there. The Xbox 360 controller. It is designed for your hand. And I, you know, sometimes I'm playing Squadrons and, you know, I love to dip back. I move, you know, back and forth. And this is the thing that, you know, stays with me when I move. So, and you know, it's games like Flight Sim or Microsoft Flight Sim where, when you're playing with the throttle and stuff, it's like, why is there a trigger on this?
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
It doesn't really translate to that. But I will say, you know, we were playing Squadrons together and you were outpacing me in a lot of those games. I'm sitting here with dual sticks and foot pedals and you're just slaying away with the controller. So, hey, if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Mm.
It's true. I mean, they use the 360 controller. Like, I remember years ago, getting those announcements that, like, the U.S. Army was replacing some of their more sophisticated control schemes and just swapping it out with a plain old Xbox 360 controller because
they,
you can't.
They had to make their own controller.
You can't do so much with it.
Microsoft didn't allow them, at least from what I remember reading. Microsoft was like, we don't want you, like, using our controllers to control drones. That's a bit weird. I don't know what the current state is, but I do remember reading that a while back. I think the Army probably developed their own clone, right? You know, that's probably the same idea, but it's kind of a weird, you know, gray area.
I'm sure a PR image seeing your gaming controller being used in operations that could lead to casualties, that might not be the
not ideal
the public image ideal, that you
yeah.
want
yeah. Cool. So yeah, like, you know, one of the things that we just brought up, and we were talking about the Zephyrus Duo and how that lower touchscreen can be integrated in part of the gameplay. And something I was reading about this past week is actually a tool that it's called Game Glass. And it basically lets you take any phone or any tablet and integrate that into the gameplay of two of the biggest space sims, Star Citizen and Elite Dangerous. In both games, you have several different screens to monitor quest log, shields on your ship, ammunition on your ship, communications, all those different things. And basically with this third-party software, you can then have, I've seen setups where there's some guy's got like three different tablets below his main screen, and they're all mirroring the in-game screens on the ship. But not only that, they're touchscreen and functional. So if you want to say, hey, I need to divert shields to be behind, you're literally touching the shield indicator around your ship on the tablet. And this is the stuff that gets me real giddy as like a space sim nerd.
Excited.
It's like, just hearing about this.
Yeah. I mean, just like the, you know, not having to go and purchase another device, but, you know, literally making those, you know, another tool.
Right.
There's something about physical touch, like where it's like a Stream Deck or something, like those are always just so satisfying.
Yeah, so, but Stream Deck is like actually what I've done before with Star Citizen, but that's all macros. This is like an actual interface. Like if you wanted to like 3D print some kind of mold and put all your displays like into this mold and build yourself a spaceship, you could. Like you could actually have a functioning spaceship at this point for these two games. And I think that's supremely cool.
Yeah.
That's giving me some ideas. Like just like how many tablets can I fit under here?
Running out.
We've been talking about like I picked up Star Citizen. I backed it 30 years ago, I think, when it first like launched on Kickstarter. So I've got a ship and stuff, and I remember like once you could finally get into the ship, I was like, okay, I'm gonna play it, I'm gonna try it, and I was like, this is cool, it's beautiful. There's not much to do. I'll check on it again in a few years, and it's been several since then, and I'm ready to get back in. And now hearing that, I'm like, what can I do, especially on the Zephyrus Duo? Like, what can I do with that? Like we might have to have an episode just about Star Citizen in this someday.
Yeah, maybe. I'm actually like really looking forward to building a special stream setup using the X13. The X13 is a new laptop. The X13 or the Flow X13 is a new device that we are releasing soon. We just showed it off at CES, where it's a 13-inch touchscreen that can be a tablet. It has four different modes. You can have it standing upright kind of deal, intent mode as it's called, and that has a PCI slot on the side where just you plug in an external GPU, and then it becomes a powerhouse device with a 5900 in it, or 5850 I think is the highest for the CPU, and then the external GPU is actually a Ryzen or a RTX 3070 or 3080. You can choose one or the other. So with a 3080, I mean, you can actually have three other displays plugged into that plus the default display that's there, and up to five USB ports, maybe six. So anyways, you can do some pretty crazy stuff with it. And I'm looking forward to seeing if I can take this 13-inch laptop and make a crazy command center out of it, with that touchscreen being a centerpiece on the experience. I think it could be, it's going to be a fun experiment when eventually we're going to do that here on stream, because that's
exciting. I can't wait to see what you do with it.
That's like, the fact that it's just portable though. I mean, like, you know how far we've come, you know, thinking that these things just were not possible,
right?
Yeah,
When, you know, we...
I mean, when Star Citizen was announced, I wouldn't have considered even trying to play it on a gaming laptop back then. Like, just the state of, I mean, it was what, 8 years ago? Like, it was...
Yeah.
Gaming laptops were in a different position than they are now as far as portability, size, power, heat consumption. Like, we've really made leaps and bounds. So imagining someone running that kind of awesome Star Citizen command center off of such a tiny device, like even when you throw in that, I mean, the eGPU is itself is also ridiculously small,
right,
in comparison to other external GPUs.
Oh, you're not even going to see the eGPU. It's going to be in the back, tucked away. It's going to be your command center, everything plugged into it, and you're not even going to know it's there. You know, it's
that's really amazing. Cool.
And then there's no desktop on your space, so it's some really really exciting hardware. It, you know, it seems like we are progressing in that regard, but
right, I feel like especially with the 30 series launch, like I felt like we went you know, we're exponentially growing and moving in the right direction, especially for mobile gaming. And you know, flight sims are taking off, and they're really, you know, dependent on this hardware
taking off.
So I mean, it's just, it's really dependent on the hardware, and I love seeing where this is going.
It's cool. It's cool. All right. Another thing we can talk about is just kind of, you know, the, we, a lot of these people that do build sim setups, are investing more in either doing triple monitor with small bezel to try to create that wraparound, or just ultra wide. And have either of you guys, ever used an ultra wide? Because I have not. And I'm sad because I feel like that would be perfect for these kind of games.
Yeah. I'm staring at an ultra wide right now. So I play most of my games on an ultra wide, and in some games it doesn't make a ton of difference. But other games, it's just, so it adds to the immersion of having just that extra, instead of being limited to kind of here, it's taking up, you know, so much of my peripheral that I can see more. And even in some games, especially flight sim games, like when I'm, you know, flying in my X-Wing and I'm tracking a TIE fighter, and it's at the very edge of my screen and I can see it, on your screen you can't, because you're narrowed down if you're on a regular, like say 1080 or 1440, even 4K. If it's not as wide as mine, I'm getting a wider field of view, and therefore I'm able to kind of track targets and stuff a little bit easier.
Of course.
And it just, I don't feel like I'm wearing these blinders when I'm looking around. It's like, okay, I can see a little bit more. But I also, like, I've used triple monitor setups before as well, and they come with their own, because you can fill so much even more of your periphery with, you know, all of that. But it's a little more complicated.
It is, and you got to get the proper kind. You got to make sure that they're lined up, and you got to maybe have a single rack for that. I actually do have a triple monitor stand for that purpose. The problem for me is I didn't have three similar displays. It's like two of them were 1080p, one of them was 4K, and it's like, yeah, this doesn't really work that well, guys.
Yeah, and those bezels, you know, it could really ruin the immersion sometimes. Yes. Yeah,
that's why we have our bezel free kit, though.
We do, actually.
That's true.
You can just set those on between each of the two monitors on your left and right, and it actually, it uses black magic. I've confirmed it. It's black magic. But it completely eliminates the visibility of the bezel, and it just looks more like you're just seeing one huge display all across. So it's definitely budget, something worth checking out. Yeah, it's
the budget curve monitor.
Yes.
Yeah.
That is cool.
But no, have you, either of you, used a triple screen setup before?
Yeah, but not very successfully with games. I find that to get that resolution done well for a single game, like downscaling a 4K display to 1080p to make it work, it always felt a little clunky to me when I did it. It might work better for some games than others, but it's just like the actual angle in which I'd put my display wouldn't line up with the angle that it's showing me in the game, you know? And I just feel like to fine tune that for how often I'd use it wasn't worth the experience. I gave up on it like immediately. I really
exactly
did.
Yeah, I had a buddy who did one and he used it for racing sim, and again it was they were all different sizes, the bezels, all of those things, and I just got completely removed from it because it was just it was in the way, and it really took away from the experience. And I just figured if I was going to do something like that, I would always go curved.
Yeah, I think the ultra wide is the way to do it. I was actually at PAX East like last March, right before the whole world stopped. And there was a, I don't remember what game it was, but they had two or three ultra wides connected. And it was like at some random booth, right? I don't even remember what, I don't know if they were selling displays, I don't know what they were selling, but it was just like, it looked cool as hell. But I can't even imagine like what.
That's a full circle at that point, right?
It was almost.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, it was what's the calculator?
It was a
like,
full. Yeah, it was pretty much all the way around you. Not like behind you, but, you know, from here to here, you're encased by displays.
I really wonder, like, how many of our XG43 UQs would it take to make a full wraparound circle?
Is that.
Because it's what? They got an 800 curve on them. I don't know. I'd have to do the math.
43-inch display. Yeah, that's. I don't know. I feel like
a
couple of them.
It's still a subtle curve.
I feel like you have two of them, like, and you're like pretty much set.
Right.
Like for life.
But yeah, when I feel like I've seen more than two, that's where motion sickness kind of kicks in for me.
Huh.
I don't know why. Okay. But it's when there's those curved monitors, one or more. That's where I feel like kind of, you know, the warp feeling effect that I've experienced like with motion sickness before. So to me, like that's where I've experienced it. But. Mm. You know, I don't know. I'm definitely willing to try the circle of monitors, of curved monitors.
Well, you know, something that's really cool with, again, back to Star Citizen. Star Citizen supports face over IP. So FOIP basically takes, you can either use webcam, or there are special devices made for this where it tracks your face. It's tracking your eyes. It's tracking your mouth. It's tracking where you're looking. So when I tried it this weekend, and it was one of the most hilarious things ever, just because like it's trying to, when I'm doing like the character creation, it's trying to match my eyes and my mouth and stuff, and my character's just like he looks like so, and it's because the glare of the light on my glasses and everything else, it just couldn't capture my face well enough, where that was very funny. But when it came to actual gameplay, you were talking about how, you know, in Squadrons you can see more range around you. Well, I could actually turn my head gently like this, and my point of view in the game would shift to look out that side window. So as I'm passing by like a station or another ship in a dogfight, I'm like, where'd he go? I can actually, you know, gently turn my head like this while keeping my eyes on the screen. It's not as good as VR, but it actually felt way more organic than I would have expected.
Speaking of VR, so have you done any flight simming in VR?
Dude, I can't wait. I haven't yet because I'm building a new streaming room, and I don't want to mount the base stations on the walls in this room.
Lightbox.
So, yeah.
Base stations. I've only played, I played Elite Dangerous. This was back when VR was, I guess, kind of kicking off and everyone was showing it off at E3 and CES and stuff. But I played Elite Dangerous. And that was really exciting because it was that same like with Racing Sims too. It's that like I want to see what's going on over there, and instead of trying to press a button that toggles my screen to look over there, I just look over there. It's just like, oh wow.
Okay, so I've totally forgot I did play Elite Dangerous, and it was here's the problem, and here's where we can have this conversation as to why VR might not be as good as building like an ultra wide setup. The immersion was unreal until it came to actually trying to like figure out where the hell my controls were. So I had never played Elite Dangerous before. I bought it for this purpose, but I, you know, I've got like a gaming chair. Speaking of the ROG Chariot, what a beauty.
Beautiful.
So I was in a gaming chair, which is like a bucket seat, which is like a cockpit, you know, that's cool. I had a flight stick and a throttle, and I positioned them so that it looked exactly like where I was reaching in the game, was grabbing the flight stick, right? I matched it up like perfectly when I was playing. So that felt really organic and incredible. But then it's like, okay, push this button to like, you know, remove your landing gear or whatever. And I have no idea what button does what. In fact, I don't even know the layout of my flight stick at the time yet. And I'm looking to touch it, but I've got a visor on my face, so I can't physically see it. So that killed it. That killed the immersion for me. And I think the fix is like maybe these companies, like the bigger companies that make flight sticks, need to get their flight stick built into the game so that it can be swapped out for all these different models to like kind of build that like one-to-one immersion so that you can look and see it, and if you position it correctly, that would be cool. But
yeah, I think for that to for VR to be completely viable in a sim situation, yeah, we need one, we need to be able to see what we're doing like that. So yes, like having full integrated models where you can swap out and even adjust positioning based on yours, and then the hand tracking, like
yeah,
actual hand tracking without sensors, which we do have some of that in some of the headsets, but we need to have that in all of the major headsets and have it supported in game. So then you can see when you look down and you need to hit that button, you can see your hand going down and hitting a button on your flight stick,
right?
As long as everything's, you know, been positioned right, and then it's just becomes kind of a natural thing. I think once we're able to do that, you're going to be, you know, hard pressed to get that you know, headset off of me, because I'm just going to want to be immersed in that kind of experience so much.
There's the pro of having a Xbox controller. It's always glued to your hands and you never second guess where you're pressing.
Yeah.
Unless you go play your Nintendo and then you're like, press X to do this. And you're like, wait.
Oh, wait. Yes.
Yeah. Oh, no.
Yeah. Well, a lot of it comes down to just practice too. Like if I was to go into squadrons in VR, which it does support, I know my way around my control scheme now. I've played that game enough, you know, where I can, you know, figure out what I'm doing. And I feel like that would be an incredible experience. And I look forward to doing that, you know, in the near future. But with a game like Star Citizen, you know, Star Citizen is a game where you're not always in the cockpit. There's an FPS portion of the game where you get out and you have your gun and you can run around a space station and shoot people. Because that's what else would you do? Or you could just be friends with them and hang out and dance. You could do that too.
Why not?
But it doesn't really translate well to that kind of VR experience, because you know the tech's just not there yet. You'd have to like get out of your chair, like push your chair back, stand up, like walk around your chair carefully, and like get up to the free space. Like it just sounds like a weird.
And who's got the room?
I specifically built my new office so that it's 13x13, which is the ideal VR space for the base station technology. Which, you know what, I was about to go on a big VR tangent and like dive into VR, but our next show next week is going to be covering VR, so we'll hold that off till next week where we can really dive in on where VR tech is going. There's a bunch of new stuff shown at CES. The hardware that's available, all these new graphics cards, all these new PCs make VR more accessible than ever before. But that's going to be our next show, so we can get back into flight sims and stuff. I don't even know where to bring us back into though, because we're just kind of.
What was your first flight sim? What was your guys' first flight sim that you ever played?
Star Fox 64 is what sold me on that whole idea, right? You know, playing a space, you know, playing as a spacecraft, an aircraft, whatever. Was that you guys too?
Right. Yeah, me too. Star Fox 64, you know, right launching in the Cornelia. Like that is, you know, the moment, it's almost a game default, like the moment that I got in the video games.
Isn't
really.
Isn't it Cornelia? Or
Cornelia. The first system of the Lilat system is under attack by Angela. Yeah, okay, that's the opening text.
I'm trusting Brian here. Yeah. I'm trusting Brian. He seems real.
Cornelia. I think it's Cornaria.
Cornelia.
Is it L or R?
I am not sure.
Google it for me.
Cornaria. C-O-R-N-E-R-I-A.
Oh, dang it.
you know why I know? Because
got schooled, Brian. Well,
because you're a Smash player.
Yeah,
huh?
it's a map in Smash. I was like,
But I know for sure that level starts with, you know, the water. You're going over the water. Peppy's getting trailed. All that stuff. And, you know, that's where really you can go in the first person mode and feel the full immersion of, you know, the wings dipping and everything. And
the Rumble Pack was a concept that didn't exist, and it was actually bundled with Star Fox. I don't remember if the game was $10 more or not because of that, but that's how you got a Rumble Pack, was you purchased Star Fox 64. I still remember the crappy video Nintendo made. They used to, it was part of Nintendo Power, maybe. I had the VHS of it, where they like showed off like these two guys like creeping outside like the Redmond, Washington, like Nintendo headquarters, like trying to sneak and find out what the secret is. And it was the Rumble Pack was in the lab. It was so corny, but I still remember that video to this day. So clearly it was fun. Yeah.
And my Rumble Pack still works to this day. No lie, like, yeah, it clips right into the bottom of the controller, and you know, talk about immersion, and how far we've come. So
Rumble Packs also make great door stops. They're heavy, they wedge right underneath the door.
I mean, it was like, oh man, that thing was like 3 pounds. At least that's what it felt
and
like.
Yeah, they're finding heavy. Those secrets in Zelda and stuff. You gotta,
that's right,
wait for that rumble. It's like, oh, I gotta drop a bomb here so I can find some fairy cave or something down there.
Mm-hmm. You know, for a lot of games, I feel like that's one of the one of the few things that you get as part of the experience that you do not get in PC, is that rumble, like that feedback. You know, if you're doing something right or wrong or whatever, sometimes rumble is an indicator. That is a nice thing. But you know, it is what it is.
We're seeing more developments with that, especially with like adaptive triggers.
That's true.
That's something I would love to see in flight sticks. Maybe, you know, when you're pulling back on throttle, you get a little rumble, you know, forward, you know, that would be fun.
That would be neat.
Haptic feedback, man.
Haptic feedback is nice. The future. Yeah, it is the future. We're starting to see that develop for VR, but again, we'll talk about that next week. How about Rogue Squadron? I think that was probably the other one, that the other big one that sold people on it. But it feels like we got Star Fox 64, we got Rogue Squadron. There was obviously like X-Wing vs. TIE Fighter on PC, another classic. But then there was this huge gap where there were just no like space sims, flight sims. They created a Star Fox game where you're running around on the ground with like a staff, like
dinosaurs.
They just like, it's like, no, the genre was like abandoned, it feels, for a long time.
It really was. Yeah, I started out, I was a PC guy. And I think my first flight sim game was Microsoft Flight Simulator on a Mac, of all things, which I thought at the time was just like crazy, because it was, you know, like 1995, and Microsoft and Apple, they hate each other and nothing works. But that was one of the games that it's like, oh my gosh, I can play a PC game on here. And I was terrible at it. My brother and I, you know, we shared the family computer, and we would just like challenge each other to try and just land the plane, which we could spend entire days just trying to like get it right and actually land it. And then from there, it was, you know, X-Wing, TIE Fighter, X-Wing versus TIE Fighter, Alliance. I was just obsessed with these once I finally got a PC and could play some DOS games. Like, I conquered those games. I remember, to the point where I would fly in with like an X-Wing or something, and it's like, I'm gonna take out this Star Destroyer by myself, because you can. It just takes a long time. But, and you're right, there was such a lull, because after that it was like, okay, Rogue Squadron, you know, Star Fox 64, these are exciting games, and then just kind of nothing. I think the last one I was really excited about was Star Wars Galaxies Jump to Lightspeed. It was an expansion, but it added, you know, a whole space sim side to the game.
Wait, really?
Yeah, in 2004, Jump to Lightspeed was released.
I didn't know this ever
existed.
You could
spend all of your time in space. Like, that was kind of what got me into it, because I could go on for days about Galaxies, but they kind of ruined the gameplay with the NGE experience. If you played, you know what that is.
But
Jump to Lightspeed was the closest thing to feeling like I was back in an X-Wing or a TIE Fighter game. And it had so much more, you know, different customizable, you know, parts, guns, shields, hull, stuff like that. And you could fly with your friends. Like, you could get, you and I could be in the same ship flying around, which in 2004 was just like, exciting. So I don't know. After that, though, it really did feel like it kind of dropped off. And there wasn't anything to get me excited again until, you know, like Star Citizen was
Elite Dangerous, Star Citizen, you know, they were the games. And frankly, Squadrons was a surprise announcement, because it is a niche market, you know, for the average person. The experience is, you know, totally different. I think they did a really good job with the campaign. It's short, it's simple, but the mm-hmm. multiplayer is pretty fun. They're continuing to balance it, add ships. There's a bunch of cosmetics and stuff. Like, and suddenly, you know, we've got those. We've got Everspace. Everspace 2 just went into early access. Mm-hmm. No Man's Sky is pretty infamous, but it's mm-hmm. it's the game that, you know, it's delivered a promise and got so much better and continued to deliver. Yeah, exactly, right? You know, it's incredible, and now it's just suddenly it feels like there's this whole great ecosystem of space mm-hmm. sims and flight sims, but mostly mm-hmm. space sims. Mm-hmm. There's actually a flight simulator as well. I can't think of what it's called. It's like an acronym that people always call it, but it's like real airplanes, and it's like a flight sim, like dogfighting simulator.
X-Sim or something like that, but that was an old one.
There's a new
X-Plane.
One.
X-Plane.
Aerial Combat.
DCS. I don't...
Yes.
Something Combat Simulator.
So. Yeah.
Someone in chat just said DCS, and that definitely sounds right. It's like something Combat Simulator, but maybe it's Dogfight Combat Simulator. I don't know. But yeah, I think it's like Star Citizen where you have to purchase the ship that you want to pilot, and I think it's like the same business model where it's like, okay, I'm going to buy an X-Wing. Well, you can't buy an X-Wing. But... I was trying to think of a real ship. I can't think of a single real-world ship because I'm just all into Space Sims.
Digital Combat Simulator.
There we go.
Yeah.
That's
it. You're the real MVP.
So have you guys played any of the games where you actually work cooperatively to pilot an entire starship? One of the more popular was the VR. Star Trek came out with one, was Bridge Crew. And where it's like you and three friends, I think it is, and you each have your station where you've got like your captain's chair and you're directing certain things. You've got your engineer who's, you know, boosting power to the warp nacelles or whatever, and you're collectively working together to pilot a ship. Have you guys ever played any of those?
I mean, Star Citizen has that. So yeah.
Star Citizen. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So
if you have a big enough ship, yeah. Like there's some that have like. There's a new one that's basically the Millennium Falcon where there's a turret that goes up and a turret that goes down. So you have like the two turrets. You've got the main pilot seat, which has a co-pilot chair, just like the Millennium Falcon. So it's two pilots in the front. One's piloting, the other one's, you know, managing shields, all that kind of stuff. And I believe there's a shield room as well. And there's even a chessboard in that ship.
Oh, it's definitely the Falcon.
No, it's straight up the Falcon. Like in every, it doesn't look like the Falcon, but in terms of what it has,
it feels
in like mm-hmm. like that common room and like, you know, everything, it really functions like the Falcon. So yeah, it's pretty cool.
I picked up Elite Dangerous when it first came out, or like when it was in its really infancy in like 2015. In that game, it was a struggle to play with friends because we had to try and find each other, try and locate each other. And that game has improved so much. I mean, I've been watching Twitch streams of people playing that and just watching them, you know, all collaboratively move these vessels through just the infinite galaxy. And just hearing the banter back and forth while they're in these ships is so funny.
I gotta try that game more.
Yeah. That game has really, really picked up. And we're really starting to see, you know, a lot of Twitch streamers too, you know, that are in these like groups together really start to integrate into these ships, and you see their characters just really pop out.
But those are all like single pilot ships, right?
No,
they're not. They do have larger ships now.
They have larger ships now. I know they have like fleet carriers pretty much you could have like,
you can get out of your seat and walk around the ship.
Yes.
Okay, cool.
And I've been watching, you know, when they're traveling between back and forth, you know, they have these intermission times where they're working on these vehicles.
Right.
While it's in flight. So that is extremely interesting. And watching, you know, the crew just assemble and work together is the future of flight sims.
Yeah, I think that kind of cooperative gameplay it's something that I've been desiring, because it's one thing to play with friends, but to like cooperatively try and move some monster of a machine through space and accomplish tasks is just such an exciting thing. Artemis, I don't know if you guys have heard of it, but it was another kind of cooperative piloting sim, and you had different missions and stuff, and we would do it on LAN, and I would do this at my old house, and I had this whole basement gaming area, and there were, I think, six stations, and we had a PC for each station, and we set it up like the bridge of a ship, and the main screen was a projector that I had on the far wall, and we had lighting, sound effects, and stuff, and we would just, we'd stream it sometimes, and it was just like this exciting, like, can we do this? Because the missions were like really hard, and you had to nail what you were doing. But like, usually by the end of the night, we had one of my friends, his name's Kevin. When he would drink, he was just the best captain. Like, when he wasn't drinking, he was just kind of like, okay, maybe we should do this or that. But like, 1 a.m. rolls around and it's his turn for the captain's chair, and he would just be like, okay, set to max lasers, we're gonna fire on that, now we're gonna arm our torpedoes and hit that ship, and we're gonna reverse and get out of here.
He was there,
and by God, we do it. And it's just like, Kevin, what are you even? He's like, I don't know, man, this is just what I'm seeing, it's what we're doing, let's do it.
Because
and...
from a bloodline of pirates where they were all captains on the ship, and he just gets it.
Yeah, he was right. The type of captain to go down with the ship, for sure.
Absolutely, yeah. And we would go down with him, Chris, absolutely. Yeah. We were ready to.
It honestly sounds like you need to play Sea of Thieves, like, more than anything.
Yeah, I do. I need to play it again. It's been a long time.
I was playing. I actually played for like 5 hours last night with my crew, and you know, it's
hit me up sometime.
Yeah, I just started playing it for real, and it to get that experience of like working cooperatively, mm-hmm. like to achieve something, and when. You know, a random fight starts happening and you gotta maintain the ship and put the fires out, mm-hmm. and still not crash into something. It just feels, you really gotta have that coordination. It feels really good. And Star Citizen is definitely aiming to be that. And it sounds like Elite Dangerous is getting there. Star Citizen is definitely like bare bones in terms of the functionality of that, because your ship will be on fire. There's nothing you can do about it, though, right? There's no yeah. there's no tools to deal with that. It's just like, okay, well, I guess our lights are going to be flickering until we can go to a space station to get repairs. but it's kind of neat. I wanted nice. To...
Yeah, I think that type of cooperative play is kind of the future, especially
yeah.
in this...
Especially in this the world we're in, yeah.
pandemic age that we're in. It's like, I want to interact and work together with my friends to do things and not necessarily just be competitive against. I like working together. You get to have those exciting moments that you make the fun of captaining a ship or like, well, I guess, another ship in Sea of Thieves. But
yeah,
I think that's what we need right now. It's just more of those types of experiences.
That's like what I'm all about. Like I come from this esports background, and lately I want so much less competitive gaming in my life and so much more just cooperative, like let's do something as a squad, and getting that, you know, with a ship or something like that, and the experience is really fun. Maybe that just means I'm getting old, boys. I don't know.
I feel it too, man.
This on screen is my late game dream goal. That's Oof. Just like building a sim rig with, you know, imagine 43-inch ultra wide display in the front and center, two or three of them. Sounds excessive. I feel like one would be enough for me. But that's
go big or go home.
Yeah.
That's kind of how I look at it, but and then Brian, who mans our TikTok and is the master Ooh. Of TikTok, posted this video that I don't know how to restart. I'm like an old man that does not use TikTok, so I'm gonna let the video
okay.
just refresh
yeah.
play through. I'm just gonna wait. No, I'm just gonna let it play through. We're almost there. This guy, I assume he's in Japan. I think that's a Japanese character. Okay.
Oh, this video.
Yeah, this is incredible.
It's a full Gundam build. Now, we sold these Gundam components in Japan last year. He's got an NFC that like his phone connects.
Watch the monitor come down. Here we go.
Oh my God. Like,
I feel like I'm watching Grandma's Boy or something.
And then he opens Office 365. Like, what? That's a sin. It's like, you know, I'll pull up some crazy Gundam game, man. Like, let's go. No.
Gotta get work done first.
Yeah, but that video went viral overnight. I mean, I think it has like 7 million views right now. And, you know, the demand and just like the direction that people are going, especially, you know, stay at home when the world is the way it is, you know, those are becoming more popular. I mean, going back to how you discussed about, you know, Star Wars Squadrons, that game kind of rolled out in like 3 months
yeah.
from like announcement to, you know, release. So, you know, we're starting to see that direction and people are definitely interested.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Just like thinking about this Gundam cockpit, I'll tell a quick story. I went to Tokyo probably like 12 years ago, and even back then they had arcade games. Maybe it wasn't. Maybe, yeah, I think it was like 12 years ago. They had an arcade where there was 8 Gundam pods, and basically it was teams of 4. Maybe there's 10 teams of 4 or 5. Or you'd had to go like this. You had to be a regular. You had to purchase a Gundam license. I still have it. It's like a plastic card. You have to purchase a license. You need to load funds onto it. This is your profile. You create a character. You create a profile. And then when you play, you earn points. So as you earn points, you unlock different Gundams and different upgrades and things. But it's like a city or a space map or whatever. And it's just like a Gundam simulator where you have foot pedals. You have 2 joysticks. You're running around swinging, shooting, whatever. It was a crazy experience. And that was 12 years ago. So I don't know what Japanese arcades have nowadays, but Gundam is definitely very popular in Japan.
Totally. Totally.
Gundam never dies.
I was there last year. I was in Akihabara, and I spent a full day in an arcade on like the 5th story doing a flight sim, you know, combat, you know, the full immersive thing, and I had all my buddies in the pods next to us, and
it's cool.
It's unmatched.
Akiba.
Yeah.
Weebland.
Someday I'll get there.
it's great. I went again a few years ago, but we didn't go to any arcades because I'm a fraud. It's a lot of fun stuff. I think there's a lot to look forward to, especially, you know, as you pointed out, Chris, we're looking for things to entertain ourselves at home. And, you know, there's plenty of games you can play, but I feel like the world is playing more games than ever. So it's fun to like find something to differentiate the experience. I think that's kind of why I've been leaning towards flight sims a lot myself. VR is on the rise. And that's going to be our topic for next week. We're going to dive in to discuss all things VR, haptic feedback, gloves. Gabe Newell actually just posted there's like a 10-minute interview he posted today where he's talking about, you know, reading your brainwaves and that being the future. And he actually truly believes that. So I think that's going to be a fun conversation. Right. It's going to be a fun chat. You know... Yeah, I think that's probably where we're at. If you haven't played Half-Life Alyx, you need to. It's a must. It's a must. Yep. We're going to roll to the shout-outs. Chris, we'll start with you.
Big shout-out to my brother. He's watching the stream right now. And we've been doing some squadrons together and flying together. So big shout-out to my co-pilot over there.
Brian, Mr. TikTok. Yes.
Yeah, big shout out to the TikTok guys that, you know, shoot over all the content and, you know, are generating a ton of content and always tagging us. So it means a lot, and we get to see a lot of fun stuff like that Gundam video. So, yeah,
that video is legendary. Like, I'm so jealous. I saw that and I was like, man, my new streaming setup is not sufficient. Someday.
How about you? You got what's your shout out today, Jake?
Yeah, thank you everyone for tuning in. It's fun to just jam with the boys, talk about video games. Obviously, I'm way deep into this space sim thing, looking at super high-end flight sticks. My wallet is crying endlessly. But it's fun to have something to look forward to, and it's fun to just kind of chat about things. I'm really pumped to talk about VR next week. We actually did a pilot for this when I first started working with Asus. Chris, myself, and Jeff, we did a pilot where we talked about Half-Life Alyx and VR technologies. And it was a really fun show, but we were still just kind of figuring things out, and we're going to be able to rehash that next week. And it's the perfect time because there's like, I mean, VR is actually feels like it's kind of hit its stride where, yes, what we have works, but we can push it to the next level soon. And I'm really, really pumped to see where that all goes. Oh, DePoe is just showing up as we're wrapping up. Rest in pieces, my friend. Good. Thanks for tuning in. Hit the follow button. We'll be back next week to talk about VR. We'll be back in a few days to talk about our new RX optical mechanical switches featured on all the new keyboards. That's going to be on RG Pulse this Thursday. I've been playing with one here for a few days now. It's a really impressive device. We'll see you then.
I love that clack.
Clack, clack. GG's, everyone.